I will be speaking today about the documentary in India as mirrored in the films made by women filmmakers. My presentation will necessarily cover the broad history of the evolution of the genre in India, since women filmmakers have been actively involved in shaping the contours of the documentary as it emerged out from the dark shadows of the emergency. Emergency, well, in India, what we refer to as the emergency is this 21-month period, beginning from June 25th, 1975, and lasting till March 21, 1977. This was called in by the then Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi, and it was during this period when elections were suspended, democracy was suspended, and civil liberties were curbed. Political critics of the Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi, were arrested in large numbers, and the press brought under heavy censorship. And this is, you know, till today, counted as the darkest blot in terms of the suspension of democratic rights in India. The year 1977, post the emergency, heralded time to speak out and to ensure that never again would democracy and democratic principles be allowed to be taken hostage. The late 1970s, early 80s, witnessed the advent of politics and groups focusing upon the protection of civil liberties and democratic rights, and the emergence of the contemporary women's movement in India. That moving beyond its earlier phase of social reforms began focusing upon gender, violence, feminism, and the law. Violence became a very major issue at this point of time, and it was the work around it and the ways that in which feminist groups came up in and women's groups came up in very large numbers was triggered by the issue of rape. There was this Mathura rape case. There's a judgment, a tribal girl had been raped. The case went all the way to the Supreme Court, and the court ruled that the girl couldn't have been raped. It was consensual because, as they put it, she was habituated to sex. I mean, that is that she was not a virgin when she had been raped. And this actually was one of the rallying things for a lot of women's groups to come up, because some of the feminist lawyers took it up. And it went on to change laws, rape-related laws. The other thing that came up during this period was the issue of dowry. And, you know, when girls were, young brides were burnt or killed in some other way by their in-laws' family because they hadn't got sufficient dowry with them. So these are the two very major issues around which women's groups organized in this period. Feminist pedagogy came to Indian academia by the late 1970s, with women's studies being recognized as a politically significant activity in the quest for gender equality. It was in these turbulent, heady times that the documentary came into its own in India. Till then, notwithstanding notable exceptions like Anand Patwardhan's Waves of Revolution, made in 1974, documentary as a genre had been largely associated with films produced by the state-controlled films division and linked in public perception with heavy-handed state propaganda. The post-emergency period saw the state monopoly over the documentary shatter. A spate of independent and deeply political documentaries, like Patwardhan's Prisoners of Conscience, made in 1978, about political prisoners during the emergency, Tapan Bose and Sohasini Mule's Bhopal Beyond Genocide, 1985, about the Union Carbide, leak of Union Carbide in Bhopal in 1984, December 1984, this film was looking at that. And Deepa Dhanraj's films on women's struggles provided a searing alternative narrative about human rights violations, economic and social inequities, and the exploitation of women to the rosy-hued state propaganda of most film division offerings. The path-breaking departure from male dominance entrenched within the commercial feature film industry, the Bollywood industry, the emergence of the documentary genre in India in the early 1980s was marked by the presence of women filmmakers, a very large number of women filmmakers, like Deepa Dhanraj, Sohasni Mule, as mentioned earlier, and also Meera Nair. Some of you might be familiar with Meera Nair's name. She went on to make some very successful feature films. But she started her career as a documentary filmmaker. Meera Nair, who in 1985 made Indian Cabaret on two cabaret performers in Mumbai, and Meera Dewan, whose anti-dowry film Gift of Love, made in 1982, was commissioned by the Films Division. They brought upon their choice in treatment of issues a female subjectivity and a conscious engagement with gender-based issues inspired by a feminist politics. By the mid-1980s, the emergence of relatively inexpensive and easily accessible portable video technology freed the documentary from its dependence upon higher-priced 16mm film. Till then, filmmaking was very expensive and dependent really on 16mm or 35mm film and rentals, but video actually changed a lot of that, and this is the early 1980s. Moreover, the idea of narrow broadcasting, which is seemed a distinct possibility with the proliferation of TV monitors and the VHS tape. Many more independently funded documentaries on video could now be made and screened across the country. Simultaneously, the setting up of film schools, like the Mass Communication Center in Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, with an emphasis upon documentary filmmaking, brought into the field an influx of young and trained filmmakers, with a notably higher percentage of women directors. And I was amongst the earliest, earliest graduates of, at Mass Communication Research Center. Till then, most of the documentary filmmakers had been trained abroad. Sid Anand was trained in Canada. Someone like Meera, I think, was at NYU. So this is actually, it is through in the early 1980s that film schools started coming up. Deeply influenced by the vibrant women's movement, our individual and collective struggles as women for equal status, equal opportunities and dignity within our families and in the university had opened us to the truth of the feminist dictum, the personal is political. And many of us as students, as women students, had taken part, had actually initiated protests in our universities on, say, violence on the universities, safer universities, taking over, take back the night. And we had all those kind of protests, or fighting sexism within college, because early in the 80s, most colleges, even in a place like Delhi University, were hugely male-dominated spaces. And there was a big struggle that women students had to put up to be recognized as on an equal footing. And of course, there was the family space, which also had to be negotiated or fought by many women. Many of us were also engaged with issues related to human rights, social and economic inequities, and the rise of right-wing, identity-based sectarian politics. This was also the time, I was a student, I came up, I graduated in 1987. The early 1980s had seen, like this anti-Sikh pogrom almost. Indira Gandhi had been assassinated by two of her bodyguards who happened to be Sikh. And this was used as an excuse for large-scale violence in Delhi, which was, for many of us, our first experience of seeing violence, sectarian violence. Delhi is a capital city and very cocooned place, and then suddenly we saw the streets, bursting aflame. So it had shaken us up. And this is the kind of process we were coming from. 1984, Bhopal gas tragedy had happened. And these had all actually in their own way horrible and awful as these events were. They had marked also the politicization of many young university students at that point of time. The documentary had seemed to us young metropolitan Indian elites the ideal genre that we could use to show the murky realities of inequalities and injustice around. the genesis of the word documentary, that is to document, provide evidence of the true facts of a case, and to educate, reflect quite accurately the manner in which the genre has been understood, not only by the majority of its spectators, but also by many of its practitioners. It is probably the only art form which is obsessed with truth, a truth based on reality that it believes can be captured and shared. In film school, though we were introduced to the major milestones and debates within the documentary genre, beginning with Vertov's vision of Kino Pravda or film truth, to American direct documentary's emphasis on transparency, to French cinema verite and its insistence on acknowledging the constructed nature of a film. It was the Griersonian vision of documentary as creative treatment of actuality that was continually emphasized upon us. In fact, John Grierson, who's also called the father of British and Canadian documentary, it is he who coined the term documentary. Differentiating between a mere accumulation of facts in newsreel, Grierson had emphasized the work of the documentarist as one who gathers material and puts it together in specific ways and with the intention to educate a social body. This was so in line with, you know, the Soviet-inspired vision of nation of using mass media, including films, for the purpose of bringing about social change, that it inspired the founding fathers of post-independent India, and had also led to the setting up of state-funded film schools where many of us had been students, that it's not surprising that Grierson's approach to documentary should have provided the guiding light to many of the institutions where we studied. Grierson had in more ways than one also provided inspiration for the documentary form as a propagandist vehicle that took roots in post-colonial India under the aegis of the state-controlled films division. It is noteworthy too that the young, fiercely political, socially committed avatar of the documentary that emerged in India from the 1980s, even while debunking the state propaganda peddled by films division, seems to have shared films division's Griersonian vision of the documentary as evidence to inform and educate the audience about the truth. Passionately committed to exposing the reality of injustice and exploitation and motivating their audience to struggle and resist, these films in turn provided inspiration to young film school graduates like us. The period from the mid-1980s onwards, in which many of us made our first films as independent filmmakers, was defined by the growing dark clouds of identity-based sectarian politics. This period saw the rise of the Bharatiya Janata Party, the BJP, the Hindu right-wing party, which is of course now in power in India. It also saw the rise of fascist groups aligned to the BJP, these militant formations, which were trying to find their strength and establish their moorings over issues like the Ram Janmabhoomi temple issue, where there's a mosque became a contentious issue, a mosque in Ayodhya, which the Hindutva right wing said was the birthplace. The site of that mosque, the Babri Mosque, was the birthplace of Lord Ram, and there was the entire mobilization in 1980s and 1990s took place around it, resulting ultimately in the destruction of the mosque and unleashing huge, large-scale violence. In 1985, responding to the controversy generated over the issue of a divorced Muslim woman's right to claim alimony from her former husband that came out of the Shahbano case, a whole lot of things were being played out during this period. If there was the rise of the right wing, the government wouldn't take them on directly, but was pandering to the Hindu right wing, but was also pandering simultaneously to the most retrogressive elements in the minority communities. And this was, a lot of these issues were being played out over women's rights. It always is. So this case involved this 62-year-old woman, Shahbano, whose case she had asked for alimony, she was demanding alimony. Supreme Court said she had a right to demand alimony. She had been divorced by her husband. a lot of right-wing Muslim men went up in protest, and the government actually reversed that Supreme Court judgment. The parliament reversed it. So this is the Shabano case. So over this case, a group of 8 young students from the Mass Communication Research Center came together to form an all-women's film collective, aptly named Media Storm. With no resource at their disposal save their passionate commitment to filmmaking and feminist politics, and the solidarity of well-wishers, they made their first documentary film in 1986 called In Secular India, a scathing feminist exposé of the ugly communal politics being played over women's rights. In the same year, 1986, another milestone documentary by Deepa Dhanraj, What Happened to This City, documented the rhetoric and visual expression of Hindu nationalist politics in the manufacture of Hyderabad sectarian violence in 1984. Media Storm returned in 1988 with their second documentary, From the Burning Embers, on the much publicized act of sati. This is immolation by Roop Kavar. This was in a village in Rajasthan, Diorala, where this woman, a Rajput woman, committed suicide. Well, actually, it's suicide, by immolating herself on the funeral pyre of her husband. And there's a lot of communal mobilization by, again, these right-wing Hindu groups around that event. And in 1989, Rahul and I co-directed Dhanyudh, The Holy War, one of the earliest attempts at documenting the communal politics at the core of the Babri Mosque controversy. I'll just show you an excerpt from that film. It's
किए बगैर बाबरी मस्जिद की तरफ कुछ करेंगे, कुछ होगा शायद। एक तरफ मंदिर या मस्जिद के नाम पर लड़ी जाने वाली लड़ाई के नारों से आसमान गूंज रहा था और दूसरी तरफ मुकम्मल खामोशी। जी हां, मुकम्मल खामोशी। सरकार चुप रही, बिल्कुल चुप, जैसे कुछ हुआ ही नहीं। सरकार की इस चीखती हुई खामोशी ने एक नई ताकत बख्शी सांप्रदायिकता को। सरकार परस्तों ने समझा, मैदान को उन्होंने मार लिया लड़ाई लड़ने से पहले ही।
ये जो रास्ता हमारी सरकार ने खुद निकला दिया है, साहबानों का मामला जो जज साहब ने फैसला किया उसको मोहम्मद ने नहीं माना और उसको सरकार मान गई। तो इसी पर हमको भी आता है कि जब एक मुसलमानों की बात सरकार मान गई, एक मामूली का मसला, तो ये तो हमारे पूरे हिंदू समुदाय से जुड़ा है, इसको सरकार क्यों नहीं माने, इसको सरकार अवश्य माने।
Most of the films that were made during this period were self-funded and often made with the support of women's and other voluntary groups and anti-communal platforms. Receiving a great deal of attention from the press, these films were shown widely through an informal network of people's groups, women's organizations, trade unions, and even university departments. Their dissemination marking a departure from big screen cinema house screenings that had so far defined the mandatory propaganda of state-sponsored film division offerings. The period of mid to late 1980s also saw several other documentaries on a variety of other issues. A very substantial number, if not the majority of these films, were made by women. Meera Nair made Children of a Desired Sex in 1987, and which examined the sun preference of India's patriarchal society and its effect on the status of the female child. Rahul and I, in the meanwhile, co-directed a series of films called Invisible Hand, Unheard Voices, in 1988, on the status of poor, predominantly landless, and Dalit and Adivasi women agricultural labor across India. Manjira Datta's iconic documentary, The Sacrifice of Babulal Bhuiya, 1988, narrated the violation of human rights of coal mine workers and their appalling working and living conditions. Whereas Vasudha Joshi and Ranjan Palit's Voice of Balyapal, also made in 1988, explored the non-violent resistance by fishermen and farmers to attempt to displace them by the government from their traditional homesteads to make place for a missile testing range in Balyapal, Odisha. At the close of the decade of the 1980s, the documentary as a genre finally seemed to have arrived in India. With some notable exceptions, films in this period were cast very much within the framework of a cinema of protest. Rooted in social realism, these films drew their strength and logic from documenting shared experience of injustice, exploitation and discrimination, and collective resistance of the disprivileged and the dispossessed. The very large number of women filmmakers, part of this movement, occupied not the ladies' compartment of women's film of women's filmmaking, as suggested by well-meaning but often misinformed and misplaced attempts to categorize women filmmakers and their work as a category existing on the margins of the genre, but instead were very much the drivers of the fledgling documentary along with male filmmakers. While gender and the status of women formed the focus of inquiry of several women filmmakers, an equal number turned their cameras elsewhere. The politics of gender was implicated often, but not always, within the canvas of these films made by women directors in this period. The 1980s also saw the beginning of what would get described later as the developmental documentary. These years of the Rajiv government era saw a growing collaboration between people's groups, women's organizations, and the government for the implementation of developmental policies related to a variety of schemes that included women's participation in local self-government bodies, education, etc. Documentary films too found a place within this framework, documenting the efforts made by local women's and people's groups towards project implementation. These films were mainly funded by government department in the fond hope that documentaries would generate awareness about the issues at hand and the developmental work being done by the state. What began as a trickle would later turn into a spate, but I'll talk about that a bit later in the presentation. 1990s began on a note of optimism. Three extremely significant films made by women filmmakers right at the beginning of the decade held promise of a broadening of the parameters and concerns and filmic styles informing the Indian documentary till then. New York Film School trained Nilita Vachani's Eyes of Stone, 1990, employed an observational style offset with a subtle feminist sensibility to explore the claustrophobic life of Shanta, a young woman believed to be possessed by spirits in rural Rajasthan. Documentary veteran Deepa Dhanraj's Something Like a War, 1991, was a spine-chilling denunciation of India's family planning program from the point of view of women's reproductive rights, and was marked by the use of emotionally powerful image-making and often dramatic narrative juxtapositions. Then there was Reena Mohan's Kamlabai, 1993, a light-touched conversation portrait of 92-year-old Kamlabai Gokhale, the first lady of Indian cinema. And this film marked a welcome departure from the often heavy-handed, self-consciously somber style that had become associated with documentary filmmaking thus far. Three Swallows, however, do not a summer make. Though the early 90s saw an upsurge of documentary filmmaking in India, marked with prolific output by growing numbers of women filmmakers, the films produced, notwithstanding some of these notable exceptions I've talked about, did little to explore film language beyond the activist protest mode in which the documentary had been set during the 80s. A focus upon gender-based inequities and injustice informed much of the work in this period, but most of this work was funded through the 90s, and especially films on gender, by government departments, or by international donor agencies. While a minuscule few of these documentaries are commissioned by state-owned television or European and American television networks, a greater number were either supported by international donor organizations or commissioned by government departments. This was the liberalization era that saw the initiation of policies from early 1990s onwards towards making the Indian economy more market-oriented and expanding. And this trend of the developmental documentary of being funded by donor organizations kind of got accelerated in this era. This came into being, really came into its own there. Cutting back on social spending, the government began increasingly subcontracting the job of implementing the little it spent on social schemes to the voluntary sector. In a related development, many voluntary and autonomous groups, including women's groups, gradually transformed into non-government organizations. Resistance and confrontation found itself being integrated into project proposals and program development and implementation. Funding from government and international donors became the preferred route of scaling up interventions. Government departments started speaking the language of non-government organizations, and non-government organizations increasingly became indistinguishable from government departments. Within this rapidly changing scenario, it was not entirely unexpected that documentary filmmaking should undergo a transformation from its unruly and unpredictable beginnings to becoming a partner in the developmental politics co-sponsored by the state, the non-government organizations, and international donor organizations. Making documentaries, even on video, is expensive. In the absence of independent cultural funding for the firm, many filmmakers, including myself, found recourse in documenting government or non-government sponsored developmental projects, or in tailoring their film proposals to fit the agendas of the increasing number of donor organizations working in the developmental sector. Increasingly dissatisfied with the social awareness generating rut that the documentary form found itself in, the mid-1990s also proved to be a period of introspection and self-reflection for many of us about our films and the direction that we wish to take as filmmakers. Apart from the obvious frustration of working within the constraints imposed by funders' agendas, There was also a growing questioning of the Griersonian top-down propagandist vision that had till now informed much of our work through the 1980s and the 90s. Our use of people's voices, whether within the political documentary of the 1980s or its developmental kin in the 1990s, was dictated by a preconceived understanding of the overall message within which these narratives had to fit in. In most of these issue-driven documentaries, any image or sound that did not fit into a preconceived agenda was usually considered excess and dispensed with, or either as either unimportant or worse, as false consciousness. The instrumentalizing of people's lives to the cause represented by the films had become a set feature of this era of documentaries. This was also the period that the internet began providing much needed access to information about documentaries being made internationally and the debates on content and form. Taking a cue, the documentary form in India came in for intense scrutiny, especially the twin notions of reality and truth, the cornerstone of the genre as many of us had practiced it thus far. Taking from Naach, who had said long ago, there are no facts, only interpretations, the value of the reality that is represented by a documentary began being questioned repeatedly, considering the slippery relativism of reality itself. This debate also opened up interesting questions related to memory and performance, and their bearing upon the truth claim of the documentary form rooted in the realities of the present. How do documentaries deal with performance, which is inevitable the moment you start filming with people? And is the non-filmic space devoid of performance? The other question is of the relationship between the filmmaker and the subject. Is this relationship of complete otherness or of shifting intersubjectivities? And if it is so, how do these shifts find a space within the film, if they do at all? Integral to this last question was the need for self-reflection upon the identity markers of the filmmaker, privileged by her class, caste, religion, education, and the power of the camera. She documents lives and social, economic, cultural realities, often far removed from her own. What is the subjectivity that she brings to these representations? This intellectual churning resulted in a creative effervescence from the mid to the late 1980s onwards. While developmental documentaries continued to be made in ever-increasing numbers, there was also the beginning of attempts to break away from the mold. In 1995, Rahul and I co-directed Cape, or The Play, a film that took us into the realm of women's spirituality, female spirituality, through a self-reflective dialogue with history and mythology linked to the now abandoned and vandalized temples dedicated to the yoginis. The film attempted to take the audience on an experiential journey to the interiority of feminine spaces, of dreams and memories that bear witness to the wounds inflicted by patriarchy.
We're going to do whatever we did this morning.
Thank you.
A sorceress was challenged by a magician to give proof of her magical powers. As a demonstration of her abilities, the sorceress transformed into a tigress and ate up the magician.
Thank you. vandalized, yet still enigmatic. These female figures leave us with no doubts at all. 1,000 years back, there must have stood here a stone circle without a roof. A circle defying all conventions of temple architecture. A circle dedicated to the cult of the 64 yoginis. Part animal, part human. Energy is so very potent, harnessed with magic. The magic of the yoginis.
I directed Snow, 1997, that traced the journey into the mountains by a group of adolescent working class girls. A vastly different film then came. It used a verite style and located itself in the everyday of adolescent dreams, desires, and aspirations. In the age of globalization and privatization of the economy and the NGOization of people's movements, perhaps it was to be expected that the small acts of subversion, the little rebellions against conformity authority, began to be focused upon more in the making of a more in filmmaking than the makings of a revolution that now seemed distant and utopian. The late 1990s also saw an interest by women filmmakers to explore gender within the prism of urban narratives, local histories, and everyday events. Portraitures contextualized within the everyday of their social, economic, and cultural lives informed documentaries made by several filmmakers in this period. The two-film Portraiture of Belonging, 1997-98 by Samira Jain, explored the intricate mosaic of the changing reality of the old city of Delhi through intimate portraits of two craftspersons. Media Storm member, camera person, and filmmaker Sabina Gadiho chose to turn her camera closer home in an observational exploration combined with interviews about the image-making and lives of three women photographers, Shiva Chachi, Dayanita Singh, and Humai Vairawala, in Three Women and a Camera. Madhushree Datta's film, An Actor Prepares, 1999, was based on a play about the life of Jaishankar Sundari, a popular female impersonator of Gujarati stage in early 20th century Bombay. The period also saw the first small steps towards making cultural funding available for the documentary. Though the funds available were small and in some instances came tied with exclusive claims by funders over copyrights and the constraints of time, the inception of such initiatives did provide an alternative to the dependence of the documentary genre upon developmental funding sources. The cusp of the end of the 20th century and the dawn of the 21st brought with it digital technology that liberated documentary filmmaking from the tyranny of expensive studio rentals and led to further democratization of the genre. It also brought an increasing focus upon the personal. The subjectivity of the filmmaker, hitherto articulated at times self-consciously through either voiceover or in conversations with the protagonist, became now the focus of several women filmmakers. I mean, this was really a women filmmakers brought personal cinema into documentary filmmaking in India, who turned the camera towards themselves. A series of very personal films for Maya, 1997 by Vasudha Joshi, my own film Sita's Family, which is made in 2001, and My Mother India, 2002 by Safina Oberoi, explored the terrain of metropolitan middle-class family histories set against the backdrop of the nation-state in making. I think we are running out of time, so I'll just skip the tip. In her first film, Bear, 2006, Santana Isar used home videos shot by her family to reflect upon the dysfunctionality of her relationship with an alcoholic father. Nishtha Jain, on the other hand, explored the class dynamics of her relationship with her domestic help in Lakshmi and Me, 2007. Sexuality too came tumbling out of the closet in this period, which saw heated debates and questioning within women's groups in India about the very puritanical Gandhian sexual morality that had informed their that had informed the discourse of the early women's movement. Issues related to sex work, obscenity, and gay rights were now being articulated and contested within the public sphere. This was reflected in documentary practice as well, through several films, including Tales of the Night Fairies, 2002 by Shohini Ghosh, on sex workers' rights, Manju Ben Truck Driver, 2002 by Sherna Dastur, about queer sexuality, She Writes, 2005 by Anjali Montero and K.P. Jaishankar, on women's writings and charges of obscenity, Morality TV and Loving Jihad, 2007, by Paramita Vora, on young sexuality, and the demonization of minorities by the Hindu right. And my own trilogy on women performers, Delhi Mumbai Delhi, 2006, about the lives of bar dancers, Naach or the Dance, 2008, about the performativity of gender and sexuality, and The Other Song, 2009, that explores the narrow sexual morality of the nation state through the lives and art practice of tawaifs or courtesans. The often fraught relationship that the women's movement has shared with documentary filmmaking in India returned full circle in the 2000s in two very different films. While Paramita Vora's Unlimited Girls, set within the irreverent space of a chat room, revisited old-time women activists and groups to explore the roots of feminism in the 21st century, Nishtha Jain's Gulabi Gang, 2012, presented a refreshingly non-hagiographic portrait of Sampath Pal and her Gulabi Gang of women activists working in the extremely poor region of Bundelkhand. In keeping with the multiplicities of realities explored by women directors in the course of this journey, their documentaries have reflected a diversity of filmic styles, from the good old activist documentary of protest to the still going strong developmental documentary, from interview-driven documentary to the more observational, from verite encounters with reality to the play between the real and drama, from self-reflexive explorations of the other to intensely personal journeys into the self. The documentaries as crafted by women filmmakers have come in all shapes and sizes.
Let's have some questions. Who would like?